the oldest city in Tennessee, and it's a very quaint place, and it's just wonderful. Here are all these special professional tellers, and just get them to tell stories, and I just get to sit there and listen. And you think, you want to go and listen to all those stories, but they're so varied and so different, it's just a wonderful time at Bitter Mountains. Now that's always the first weekend in October. So the trees haven't really started changing much, but just a little bit here and there. Well, then this year, I take a trip with some girlfriends out of town. We went to North Carolina, and I screwed up on the timing, and it was the next week after storytelling. So the trees still hadn't changed as much, but they had progressed on. But I love driving mountains. Usually that's when I'm praying, or I've got the radio, or the Christmas cantata on the CD player, practicing.
Thank you.
Singing down the road. And I start looking at the beautiful world that's around us. And I see the mountains. And they are just so majestic. But to make, and if y'all travel anywhere in the mountains, you're going to have seen this. These rock-faced mountains that have been blown away to put that road there so I can drive through. And the rest of a few friends, family, you know, driving through there. I just find it so amazing. Now, rarely is it smooth. It's jagged. And what I find interesting is the little, like a half a circle that comes down one side where they've drilled down and put in the explosive caps and blown it away to take away the rock and stuff to make that road. It's just real interesting to see that. I mean, even in North Virginia, where I was first from, they wanted to put a road on the side of a mountain. So they had Swiss engineers come in just to help them decide how to put this road that it would be stable, so they could just sort of dig a little part into the mountains and then drive, take US 23 through Powell Valley, which is a glorious God's country, and on to North Virginia. But the engineering, I watched the construction here on the roads, and they'll be working down here some and up here some, and how they made it where they're supposed to. I just think that's all interesting. So I was contemplating all this, and that rock is just so solid and strong. In the winter, when the waters come down, you see these huge icicles, and they're just so impressive. And I think about, I don't know how many years, but I know God's hand was in the creating of those, and it's just so interesting. And I'm looking, and then all of a sudden, there it is. Right in front of my eyes, growing out of that rock, is a tree. A tree. Now, some may be small, and some, these were a couple that Kathy Ann Johnston made for me. And there's been some trees that make a nice, big, tall Christmas tree. You know? But isn't that beautiful? And you think, earth, is there enough dirt on the hoe? How about that? How is there enough dirt to sustain this tree? And I guess wind blowing around and when cars drive through, they displace it and put dirt up that way. Okay, the dirt may have come that way, but it still kind of surprises me, is there enough to get the roots in there? But it does. But then, how'd the seed get there? Well, my dad had an idea on that too. His thought was that birds eat seeds around, and then they get their nutrition, and when they're done, they rid themselves of it as they fly along. And so that accomplishes two steps. That's the planting and the fertilizer. You could always come up with some unique thoughts. But, so that I'm there. thinking that's how these trees got there, and I'm sure it's still all God's plan. It's God's little garden. But I can't imagine another way. But anyway, God's just cool in using this. It just hit me that how can a tree grow out of a rock? And then I, of course, started thinking of Scripture. And in Exodus 17, 6, I pulled out some different things that talk about rock in the Scripture. And this one is Exodus 17, 6. And it's talking about the Israelites going through the desert and stuff. And this is one of their wine stages. We're really thirsty. I want something to drink. Of course, I'll be right there with them because I'll be thirsty too. And you're in a desert. And this is what happened. Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord answered Moses, "Walk on ahead of the people. Take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go." Verse 6. "I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and rock. Strike the rock and water will come out of it for the people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel. Now how about that? Only a supernatural, powerful God could do that. We can't. I haven't heard the same about the devil doing that. But our God. Ordinary people. Plain old Moses. And a plain old stick. And he struck the rock. And the water came. What an unusual way to benefit and use a rock. Well, now, this is where we're getting to the song. My next scripture. Bear with me. I thought I'd do better marking it, but I can't see where I'll put a little marker. Okay. Matthew 7, 24 through 29. And it's under a heading of ask, seek, knock. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone, I'm in the wrong place. That's good scripture too. 7:24. "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great splash." Now here's my special song, and an Emily Bear Hawks.
Thank you.
y'all didn't know. Now, anyone that's been in construction would tell you, even if you've just hung out around people doing construction, you're going to know that a good, firm, solid foundation is the right way to build a house. Well, even when you walk on the beach, I love walking on the beach, because walking on the beach makes you a little tired than walking on the highway. That's because your feet are sinking in the sand and it's shifting and it's making you look like you never walked long. I feel about two. You know? But the sand just shifts. And that just shows us again that that's not the foundation. It's not, you know, when I look at those mountains with those rocks, I know God built his earth firm and solid. Now, the next scripture, we all read the right one this time, is from Matthew 16, verse 18. Now, Jesus is talking with his disciples at this time. And he was asking, Jesus was asking, but what about you? Who do you say I am? And Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus was very pleased with that answer. And on down he said, and I tell you, Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. So that was God working on Peter. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. That's a whole other discussion thing in there. But here it is, Jesus talking and looking at a man. A man that we know is going to deny who Jesus is. But Jesus turned around and said, you are the rock. I will build my church. A rock, a person, a church. Say, what? And we do know later that Peter addresses the crowds. And what happened? The church started growing. We know that from Scripture and Acts. And then in Ephesians, Ephesians 2, 17 through 22. Starting to break ground and dig. we're standing on solid cornerstone words of God Almighty. Now, this foundation that we've already talked about, you know, in some of the other scripture, that's an important, you just got to have to build and grow from. So now the scriptures we've talked about tonight have all been about rock. And there's life-giving water out of rock. Build your home or your church on rock. These are the most important places in our lives. Our families, both. Blood, family, church family. Of course, there's the blood kin there too, the blood of Jesus Christ. But that is life-giving. How many of us retreat home for that quiet? A lot of times it may not be. Or even when the kids or the dogs or whatever are going a little while, it's nice because you're home. You know everybody there, may know you. But that's life-giving. Build the church on a rock. Salvation and freedom. Freedom from sin. Now tell me, that's not life. Jesus is the cornerstone. He provides the grace and the mercy for life everlasting. Also in these scriptures, Jesus used ordinary people to accomplish extraordinary things. Moses, he studied. He didn't want to do that. He killed a man. And God used him. Peter, cutting off people's ears, acting like he doesn't know Jesus, getting mad about it, too. And the wise man building his house. He listened to the precepts. Could that mean he is calling us to be a part of that rock? Can he build his church from us? Can we be fruitful like that tree from those rocks? He wants us to grow the church from a rock. Say what? Can we say yes to a supernatural God? Yes to the God that can grow a tree out of rock? Yes to the one who built his church on rock? Can we say yes to the only wise God? Yes to salvation and freedom? Yes to the only one who gives eternal life? Yes, Lord! Yes, Lord! Yes! 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 We join together and be a part of the rock? Can we be a part of the supernatural growing tree of the church from a rock? Our God is bigger than anything we'll ever encounter in our lives. As brothers and sisters in Christ, what's our answer to each other and to Jesus? Is it yes? Let's pray. Yes, Lord. Take us. Turn our hearts to your growth, your direction, your leading. May in our heart of hearts the seed grow that you are our rock. You love us. You will always be with us. And let's get rid of the excuses, Lord. I'm right there with them. But let us give them up because you are an awesome God. Thank you for making Red Bank United Methodist Church a place that does say yes. A place that we can come to. And fill up and be recharged. But Lord, let us say yes to the call to go out. many ways, and we do. But Lord, we ask you to multiply the harvest. We thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord.